Hypothesis testing involves making decisions about the population based on our sample data, whether to reject the null hypothesis or not. And when we do that, when we make that decision, it could be an accurate decision or it could be an inaccurate decision. And we're going to talk about those situations next. So a decision error is an incorrect decision when making an inference about a population based on sample data. A good way to understand decision errors and accurate decisions is to consider this grid. And what we're going to have on this side is the decision that we make after we look at our data, run our analyses, we compare our p-value to alpha, or we compare our critical value to our test statistic, and we make a decision about whether or not to reject the null hypothesis. That's over here. And up here is reality. And so what we're hoping is our decision matches reality, right? Let's say our research question is that our research hypothesis is that SUU men are taller than American men. In that case, our null hypothesis is that their heights are the same. So the reality could be that SUU men are taller, or the reality could be that SUU men are the same as regular Americans, as other Americans. And we could decide after we run our z-test that SUU men are taller, or we could decide that the results are inconclusive. If we decide that SUU men are taller and SUU men are in fact taller, we've made an accurate decision, not a decision error. And this, we would call this a true positive. A positive, in this context, refers to when you think you found something interesting about the world, and it refers to when you reject the null hypothesis. So if we decide that SUU men are taller, we've rejected the null hypothesis. And these are the kind of results that you would get to publish. This is what you're hoping will happen in your research. This is consistent with your research hypothesis, this cell in this table. But it's also possible that we could decide the SUU men are taller based on what our data looks like and our statistical analysis. But in reality, it could be the case that SUU men are just as tall as American men. In that case, we've made a decision error. And this one is called a type 1 error. It's also known as a false positive. So when this happens, our data supports the research hypothesis, but in fact, the research hypothesis is wrong, and we make an incorrect decision about the world. And notice that this is the kind of finding that you could publish. Both of these are publishable findings because you've discovered something, or you think you've discovered something, and here you've really discovered something, and this is what you want to publish, and add this finding to the literature of what scientists know. Here, you think you've found something, but in fact, it's not really, your finding doesn't reflect the state of the world. And so if people try following up on your research, they're going to waste their time and their energy and resources. And then if we consider down here, right? So when we run our z-test, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. and we decide that the results are inconclusive, but in fact, SUVmen are taller. We failed to discover what we were looking for because our data just didn't show the state of reality. So this is a decision error as well. We've made an incorrect decision. We should have decided this to have an accurate decision, but instead we decided this. So it's also an error. This one is known as a type 2 error. It is also known as a false negative. Negative here, referring to failing to reject the null hypothesis or thinking you haven't found out anything about the world. In this case here, this last possible scenario that could happen is that, in fact, the null hypothesis is true, and your results are such that you can't reject the null hypothesis, so you make the appropriate decision to fail to reject and decide your results are inconclusive. So this is also an accurate decision. It is a true negative. So to make things a little more clear, I also want to add to this table the null hypothesis. So this is reality up here. And so if SUU men are taller than American men, then this is wrong. The null hypothesis is wrong. So in this case, the null hypothesis is wrong. I'll say it's false. Here, the reality is that SUU men are the same height as American men. Well, that's exactly what the null hypothesis says. So here, the null hypothesis is true. In this case, the analyses suggested that the null hypothesis was wrong. So here, we rejected the null hypothesis, right? Accurately if, in fact, it's false, or incorrectly if it's, in fact, true. And down here, right, so we've had an inconclusive study, so here we failed to reject the null hypothesis, which would be good if the null hypothesis is true, but unfortunate for us if it was false, because here we can't publish our findings because we didn't find anything of interest. So you can think of these decision errors or accurate decisions in terms of the actual hypothesis you're working with, or the null hypothesis more generally. So when you're doing your research, you don't know if the null hypothesis is true or false. If you did, you wouldn't even need to do your research, right? So let's consider the situation where the null hypothesis is true. So we're going to focus on this, little exclamation point. We're going to focus on this for just a second. Now, what I've done over here is drawn the standard three distributions, right? This is the population distribution that's assumed if the null hypothesis is true. These are individual American men. The average height is 70 inches. The standard deviation is 4 inches. This is the sampling distribution, the expected means from this population with a sample size of 100. And it's got a mean of 70, and it calculated the standard error, the standard deviation of this distribution to be 0.4. And this is the actual observed sample. Now, if the null hypothesis is true, then this is actually where our sample came from, right? And samples differ, sample means differ, because of, remember how this is produced by getting a sample of 100, calculating the sample mean, and putting that down here and doing that again for a second sample. Of 100, getting its sample mean, putting that down here, and you do that over and over and over again an infinite number of times. And if the null hypothesis is true, these are the kind of sample means that you expect. And so what we do when we're doing our statistical test is we look at what our sample mean is, and we find up here how likely that sample is. And recall, if our sample is a really extreme sample, we decide our sample is not from this population, but a different one. But now, what we're talking about is the case where the null hypothesis is, in fact, true. This is actually where we got our sample, right? And so what we usually do is have our critical region on the side, and we split the 0.025 on both sides because our alpha is 0.05 and half goes on each side. Now, when the null hypothesis is true, that means due to random sampling, 5% of the time, you're going to have a random sample that's more extreme than our cutoff values, and we're going to reject the null hypothesis. So with an alpha 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis even though the null hypothesis is true. 5% of the time, we have a type 1 error. Alpha is the rate of false positives. That's actually the definition of alpha. Alpha is the false positive rate. Notice if we change alpha to 0.10, which is pretty uncommon, you don't usually do that in practice, but just to illustrate this, right, then we would split this to each side, put 0.05 here, 0.05 here, that would push these out a little bit, right? But there would still be 10% of the area of this curve where, just due to random sampling alone, due to sampling error, we would observe samples that are more extreme than our cutoffs, and we would decide to reject the null hypothesis. And in this case, we shouldn't have. We'd made a decision error, a false positive, a type 1 error. So alpha, the thing that we've been talking about, the 0.05, is when the null hypothesis is true, this is the rate that we'll reject the null hypothesis when we shouldn't have, our false positive rate. So we can put alpha down in this box here because that is where alpha is relevant. All right, next let's talk about when the null hypothesis is false. So notice reality has to be one of these two things. And you don't know which one it is when you're doing your research. So here, let's switch over to the case where the null hypothesis is false, right? We can reject the null hypothesis like we should, make an accurate decision, or we can fail to reject the null hypothesis, which would be a decision error, right? So if the null hypothesis is false, right, then when we set up how we're gonna test our hypothesis, right, we've assumed that our sample's coming from this population, and these are the kind of samples that we would expect from there, right? But if the null hypothesis is false, this is not the population where we're getting our sample. It might be shifted over a little bit. I'll just draw something in here to, so maybe that is where this blue one is where SUU men is, right? And these SUU men are taller. And if this is where we're actually getting our sample, right? If you just go down, the sampling distribution for that one is gonna be over here. And I'll just draw something. It's approximately here. All right, so this is the actual distributions that we're going to observe based on sampling from this distribution. The null hypothesis test that we're using assumes it's coming from here, but this is really where we're getting it from. And this is what we're hoping is happening, is we're getting it from a different distribution like this. Okay, now if you look down here on these distributions, we're still using this distribution when we're deciding to reject the null hypothesis or not, and we're still going to take our observed sample and we're going to compare it to this distribution. Right, but now our observed sample is a randomly determined sample from this distribution. And if our cutoff on the null hypothesis sampling distribution is right there, then all of these samples will result in a correct decision to reject the null hypothesis. Right? So those are true positives. That's what we're hoping to find in our research. We're hoping that our sample actually comes from here, right? But we don't know where the actual distribution is. So what we've done is we set up this null hypothesis and we're hoping to reject it because our sample is so extreme it's unlikely to have come from this black distribution, null hypothesis distribution. But also notice that for some samples from the true distribution, they're going to be below that, they're going to be below this threshold, and we're going to fail to reject the null hypothesis, even though our sample is coming from this distribution, right? And so sometimes we will make a false negative. We'll decide that we can't reject the null hypothesis, even though it's false. And that will happen because in reality, there is a certain amount of distance. If the null hypothesis is false, there is a population here, and it's not the same as this one. And you can actually, in reality, these distributions are calculatable. And there's a particular percent of the true sampling distribution that's below the cutoff for the critical region. Right? And that rate, that percent is how often you're going to make a false negative. And the symbol for that is not alpha, false positive rate, but beta. Beta is the false negative rate. So that would go down here. Beta is the area of this distribution that is below the cutoff where we would fail to reject the null hypothesis even though it's false. Alpha and beta differ in some important ways. So alpha is something that us researchers can decide. Right? So we never know if the null hypothesis is true or false, but we know that if it's true and we set alpha at 0.05, then 5 out of 100 times when we do our research study, we're going to reject the null hypothesis when we shouldn't have. So alpha is set by humans, and traditionally it's 0.05. Some folks think that's a little too liberal and we should make it 0.01, where only 1 in 100 times would we falsely reject the null hypothesis. But alpha is something that we know and we can decide. We never know if we appropriately reject the null hypothesis or not, but we do know overall across studies what the false positive rate should be. Beta is not something that we can decide. It is something that we can calculate, but only in special circumstances. We can calculate beta only when we actually know what the true population's distribution is like, so that we can calculate the sampling distribution and know what the null hypothesis population is like, which is actually common to know. But you have to know both of those so you can calculate the area of the true sampling distribution that's below the threshold for the critical region. And that's unusual in research because usually you don't know where you're actually getting your sample. In fact, that's kind of the whole goal of the research, is to get a sense of whether or not your sample's from this population or any other population that's not the null hypothesis. However, beta does turn out to be really important for something that we'll talk about soon, which is power analysis, statistical power analysis.